Good morning, everyone. It's a little after 11. I'd like to go ahead and get started. We have a lot to cover today. I'd like to welcome everyone to West Telecom Wednesday webinar. This is the last in the third in our series of Secure Your Home Office. Today we are joined by our partner TwinState Technologies. And TwinState has been around for over 50 years. And they have been involving in changing the telecommunication in the North Country for all of those years. TwinState prides themselves on being a security and telephony front runner here in the North Country. And they are actually a second generation women-owned business, which warms my heart as a women-owned technology business. We don't have enough women in technology. And Devi Momot and her daughter Alyssa, who is actually joining us today and will be doing the webinar on demystifying the dark web, are two role models for women in IT, front runners and extremely intelligent women when it comes to cybersecurity. Like I said, today we do have Alyssa Momot with us. She's actually the third generation of the Currier family that owns TwinState Technology and another great IT pro. Alyssa is their marketing director, and she will be the one that's actually going to be taking us on the journey into the dark web. I am Jill Van Hosen. For those of you that don't know me, I'm the information security officer for West Telecom. And I just want to do a little recap of our other two in the series. You will be getting links to these webinars. They are out on our YouTube channel and will be out there for you to review at any time. I did have a couple of questions for folks. Now, on the first webinar, we talked about your connection. Were you on DSL, fiber, or is it just a coax connection from Spectrum? We wanted you to understand what upload and download was. Maybe check your bill, do a speed test, see if you're getting what you're paying for. If you're having bad service, did you go out and see where your router's placed in your home and how many people are actually using it at this time? We also covered some basic security tips, which is really, in a nutshell, update, update, and update. Did you ensure that your firmware was updated on your router? Have you changed that default password? Have you looked into putting some multi-factor authentication on all of your applications? Those are the kinds of things we had covered in that webinar. And if you missed it, I highly recommend you go out onto our YouTube or follow the link in the email you'll get after this webinar. And please give us feedback at marketing@westtelecom.net. We're more than interested in to know what you feel about these webinars and if they've actually been informational and you've learned a few things. In the second webinar, we dove a little bit more into phishing, cyber criminals, ransomware. Those are the things that, again, due to the pandemic and the influx of folks working at home, are things that the cyber criminals are counting on. They're counting on you not patching, not performing updates on your computer. They're counting on you to hit that email that's coming from your HR that's really not coming from your HR so that they can download some sort of ransomware or something else onto your computer. Now, we did talk about this a little bit last week, and I wanted to emphasize this because I see it still happening. Facebook, stop answering all of those questions and playing those games. All you're doing is giving folks out there your personal information that 9 times out of 10 you're using in your password or you're using as security questions. Just take a moment and think about that. We're here to help you, help yourselves, and stay safe. The other thing we had discussed in that second webinar was the SHIELD Act. The SHIELD Act is something that had gone into effect in March, pretty much right after New York had gone on pause. Please go out and review that. It basically is just an outline of some good security practices for any size organization, though it is geared for those with 50 and above. And lastly, We're hoping that you've taken us up on our security manager suggestions here, excuse me, password manager suggestions here. Password, it's very, that's what they're looking for. They're looking for your passwords. And you'll see as we get a little bit more into this dark web that your information is probably out there. We also welcome you to take us up on the free trial for the virus protection. Again, a very important tool that needs to be downloaded onto your computer and needs to be used because there's a lot of threats out there day in and day out. And again, please give us your feedback on these webinars. We're more than interested. Now I'm going to turn this over to Alyssa Momont from Twin State. She's going to take us into the dark web. Many of you have probably never been out there. And I think it'll be a very interesting journey for you to see what really goes on out there, as well as discussing the difference between what people know as the dark web, the deep web, and also what we like to call the open web. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Alyssa. Alyssa, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Jill. Thank you for the gracious introduction. I'm very proud to be here, very happy to be here. And thank you to West Telecom for including us. I think what you guys are doing is phenomenal, and we're all sort of in this fight together to go against cybercrime. So without further ado, let's hop into demystifying the dark web. Little housekeeping. If you hear any barks, that little brown dog that I was holding in that image gets a little sassy when my neighbors move. So I do apologize if you hear any barking in the background. She's sleeping now, so hopefully she doesn't like that. But all right, so we'll jump right in. So demystifying the dark web. So some of you may be familiar with this image. This is used to represent the web and the internet. It's actually comprised of three different pieces. So there's the one that we're most familiar with, that's the surface web. Then there's the deep web and the dark web. So the surface web is public. Like I said, it's the one we're most familiar with. The deep web, we're sort of familiar with it, but not as much, I think, or not as aware as we are about the surface web, and then the dark web. So the deep web is private, dark web's anonymous. We'll start with the surface web. So anyone can view it. It consists of about 4.5 billion pages, which is a lot of information, but it's only 4% of all web content that's out there. And I think that's really astounding to think about all the information that's out there, and that's only 4% of it. And that's usually .net, .com, .org, .gov. And then there's the deep web. Now I have this image here to, I sort of like to compare it to what I have to do sometimes as a marketer. We do search engine optimization, and some of that involves a technique called Google dorking. There's many different applications, and depending on what your end goal is, you'll run different queries. But sometimes if I'm looking for specific pages on a certain subject on my website, I'll put site with a colon, and then twinstate.com, and whatever it is that I'm looking for so I can get some more information. So that's part of the deep web, and that's where most of our passwords are stored, medical, financial records, social media files. So when you say, hey, Facebook, I'm done, that's that group of information that you're getting back. So the deep web actually has 96% of the web information. It is huge, and it's very hidden, not quite as hidden as the dark web, but it's a little bit more protected, and there's layers. Obviously, if it's your banking information and things like that, there's certain things that need to be done in order to protect that information, but it's not to be said that it can't be accessed. So that's about 19 to 20 billion pages, and it usually requires a username and password to get to. Now the dark web is a little bit more interesting, and I think this is just astounding. So it's only about 0.01% of all the internet information. That's not to say that the information there isn't super critical and damaging to organizations. So, you know, there's passwords for sale, there's the illegal drug markets and all sorts of things that are housed there. So I do hope that everyone can hear the computer sound. So what we're going to do, and I, this should go smoothly. We've tested it. If there's any issues, please let us know, and we'll try to rectify any issues. But this is actually a recording that our sysadmin and one of my colleagues, Evan, put together. And the reason we do a recording is because of the way that the dark web is accessed. And Pete will get into that in a little bit more detail in the video. But just so that we're allowed to get through a good amount of information in a short amount of time, there is a video recording. So. And I just wanted to put these up to just some facts sort of in the recent times with COVID, and I'll talk more about it later, but it's reported cyber criminals recently netted $1.6 million from selling 239,000 payment cards on the dark web. So that's obviously a very significant number. And then why are cyber criminals on the dark web? So they use your information, your passwords and your logins and all their techniques to try to get the right login credentials to get access to your data. And I think a story that resonated with me at one point was an organization who hadn't followed proper offboarding procedures of an employee. And they had access to QuickBooks, I believe. And about 5 years after this employee had left, somebody had gained access into their QuickBooks because they didn't change that user's rights or their password or their username. So somebody found it on the dark web and thought, hey, I'll take a shot at this. And they ended up striking gold. So the next will be the video. So please let us know if there's any issues.
Welcome. This is Peter with Twin State Technologies and my cohort here, Evan.
Hello.
And we're here to talk a little bit about the darknet. So what exactly is the darknet? What we've got here is that it's a collection of computers in a private network that are all kind of seamlessly connected with each other that change their connections consistently. So your one connection going out may not be the same if you even browse to that same website. This makes it very tough for law enforcement to track if you're trying to do any illegal activity or even legal activity if you want to stay anonymous. So first, it's very easy to get there. All you have to do is go to the Tor project and download the browser. It's simply just installing to your computer, double-clicking a link, and letting it connect to the Tor. After double-clicking the browser, you're simply brought to a Google search page, as most people are used to. However, we have the difference of how we're actually connected there. I want to bring you to the sessions, Rock, so if you can actually show us the onion that's clicked. Yep, it's blinking right there. You can kind of see our circuit for this website. So what you get an idea is what website we're connected to and the routes that we're taking to get to that point. So as you can see, we're going through France, Denmark, and Germany just to get there. We've already connected and loaded up a couple websites here, because what you have to know is that when you're bouncing through as many computers as what you've seen here, all the different relays, the different countries, you're kind of relying on all of those different computers' internet connections. So whether they're fast or slow, you're subjected to it. So sometimes these websites will take 1, 2, 3 minutes just to load something very basic. Definitely not what you're used to on the surface web.
So as you can see, it is a little bit more complex, and the routing that they do is to protect your anonymity. So it is a little bit more complex. It is easy to access. We're not by any means advocating for folks to go to the dark web, but if you do so choose to investigate, it is rather easy to access.
Welcome, this is Peter with... So what we've loaded here is Torch, which is kind of what we consider the Tor search engine. Here we can search for anything and get relative search results. So Evan searched for passwords, and in here we can see plenty of paid for advertisements kind of related to it, but we can also find related searches regarding passwords. So here, for instance, we have what he's hovering over here, offering my iCloud services. I have EPPB Forensic and Wondershare can get pics, videos, messages, notes, websites. So these are people offering services to get information. down a little bit more, we have ATM hacks, we have password stealers for sale, so the Zeus mod, which is more than likely the Zeus virus that's been edited. We have SSH brute force script code there that is being available. So this is all available easily and readily on the dark web. So we found a few websites through the Tor search that are somewhat relevant to kind of explain how these illicit ne'er-do-wells go out and try to get into your services or find passwords that have already been cracked, or maybe employ the services of others to have a targeted attack against you. So here we found hack partners through the Tor search. And as you scroll down, we can kind of see their spiel here, where they are a group of dedicated and experienced IT people. They have no problems breaking into almost anything. So you can see they have all the web addresses here, or their email addresses that you can email to them with inquiries. You scroll down, and here you go. We have hackers as a service almost here. They can get into your Facebook, your email.
So I think it's really important to kind of understand what the breadth of the possibilities are with the dark web. You know, you might not be a technological guru yourself. I certainly am not, but if you see CP framing right here, that actually stands for child porn framing. So for a low, low fee of $500, and even though it's against their moral compass that they apparently have, it's only $500. So there is a lot of damage that can be done. Obviously, I think that's one of the more extreme ones. But Facebook account hacking, email account hacking, there's a lot of different things that the dark web can enable non-technical people to do.
So as we see here, this is a Black Market Guns website. So typically these websites operate near ports, near airports, maybe by, you know, coastal cities. A lot of times what will happen is you have an inside man at these ports and trade. And what will happen is these guns will come in pieces, or they'll smuggle them in, or someone will just turn a blind eye to a certain shipment. So you're paying a decent bit for these black market guns. They're usually unregistered. They're, you know, to another country, maybe completely just off the record. I mean, we don't know what has happened to these guns, but I mean, all things considered, this is actually not terribly expensive, and you're getting black market guns. So hidden financial services. So another very popular service that you'll find on the dark web is credit cards. You know, these are all stolen credit cards, Western Union transfers, PayPal transfers, maybe even hacked accounts. People will buy these for cheap, order a ton of stuff on these stolen credit cards, have them drop shipped to another location, and the person whose credit card has usually been stolen really is never on the hook for it. They get reimbursed, but you get your stuff generally. So it's a win for the hacker, not really a big loss for the person who had their credentials stolen, unless it was, you know, a debit card or something like that. Different story. But this is easy services to these people. Sometimes they'll even order drugs with these credit cards just because then it's in someone else's name, not in theirs. There's a lot of different applicable reasons for using stolen credit cards that we really don't have to go too much into. As you see here, you can see that we're on Silk Road, which you may have heard in the news, which is one of the most popular marketplaces on the dark net. See here that they are giving you the active price for Bitcoin and many of the other Bitcoin-like currencies, which if you don't know what Bitcoin is, it is, in a nutshell, a fairly anonymous form of having money. I say fairly because there are methods to track it in one way or another. However, the wallet will not determine who has it. It will not determine what you're spending it on. All it shows is that it's moving wallet to wallet in a certain amount. So on this website, you can buy number of things, anything from illegal drugs to, as we see here, Dropbox, if you scroll back up, Dropbox database, 68 million records, which include your email and passwords, for $25. So we don't know, how recent these passwords and usernames are, but for $25, someone's probably going to take their bet. We can see an MBA century with working PayPal, so we can get into an MBA. We can see they have HBO credentials, so you can watch for cheap, Spotify premium accounts, sex tapes of celebrities. I mean, you can buy just about anything on these marketplaces using a fairly anonymous form of payment. At the bottom here, we can see that they have, social security numbers and date of birth for USA, so you're probably paying about $5 a person for a full documentation to impersonate someone, to, open up credit card accounts, to scam someone. I mean, once you have all their information, it makes it a little easier to maybe even get into the rest of their accounts, because you have their date of birth, you have social security numbers.
So I think it's important to point out here too, with the Dropbox username and passwords, what hackers will do oftentimes too when they get that information is they'll take that information and they will apply it to many other different sites, and they'll just keep on trying and trying and trying. So if you're reusing the same email address and password on multiple different sites, that can be very damaging for you. So that's one thing to keep in mind, and sort of like a good cyber hygiene technique, is to just make sure that you're diversifying the email addresses and passwords that you're using across different platforms.
What we have on this page is the hidden wiki. So this is what most people who go to Tor typically look at first. So the hidden wiki gives you, as a basic user who's never really used the Onion Network before, to kind of give you an idea of what is out there. So if we start scrolling down, you can see that, we have our introduction points, which is, this is where you start, this is how you search. Going a little further, you start seeing, again, the basic financial services, like what we saw earlier, where you can go buy PayPal accounts, credit card accounts, skimmed cards, that sort of deal. We have your basic commercial services, such as guns, fake IDs, looks like diamonds and gold that have probably been stolen. A little further down, you can see domain services, how to get one of your Onion names, stay anonymous, and then anonymous email and messaging. So typically these people who are doing services on Tor will have a totally anonymous email service, such as Proton Mail, SecMail, that sort of deal. We see that there are even social networks that are based on Tor, so that way you can stay anonymous while still more or less talking to people. And then whistleblowing, which a lot of you know about WikiLeaks, which is where a lot of famous documents have popped up from, such as Edward Snowden, and I think more recently people have been leaking things from the current administration into WikiLeaks. So let's go ahead and pop over. There we go. WikiLeaks submission uploads. This looks like the website you go to upload. You can see here topics, any URLs, organizations are there, and what threat to the sources. So they do take into account, for instance, when you're doing a whistleblow, if there is any possible threat to your life or well-being. And there you go.
So I just try to thank Pete and Evan for putting that together. Hopefully it gave you a good idea of what the capabilities of the dark web are, and how easy it is to kind of access and use it, and get access to, things that can be damaging to us as individuals, and also as businesses. So we'll talk about threats a little bit, and we'll also talk about sort of some things that we can do to protect ourselves. So there's sort of three different layers of threats. You have your devices and your equipment, your network infrastructure and your connections, and your data applications and services. So Some of the threats within each one of those are data breaches, DDoS, which completely shuts you down, malicious applications, inside of threats, man in the middle. I think that the surface area of our environments now that we're all working from home have complicated how organizations can protect themselves. So we'll talk about that a little bit and some cyber hygiene things that we can do as users that can help combat that. So this is the NIST cybersecurity framework. We have built our cybersecurity stack on it. You can visit NIST.gov/cyberframework for more information on it. But basically NIST got together and they were like, what can we do to help small, medium organizations and large organizations to protect themselves? So they sort of came up with a 5-step process. So identify, protect, detect, respond, and recover. In this framework, they have a ton of information on their website. So if you're not really ready to take this step with a partner, or if you feel you don't need a partner to help you walk through the cyber framework, you can definitely grab a hold of those resources at NIST.gov. They are great, and I think they're a really reasonable exercise for organizations to go through, even if they do have a current partner, just to sort of walk through and reevaluate maybe some of the things that we're doing. Organizations change, you know, the work from home experience has definitely changed environments. So I think that it's good to keep on continuously evaluating our systems and our environments. This is a quote from my mother, who is our CEO at TwinState. She always says this: if everything is important, then nothing is important. And what she means by this is sort of starting with that NIST cybersecurity framework at that identify stage, right? You have to identify your crown jewels. What is most important to your organization? So you can come up with a plan that helps protect those specific things. Hackers are really smart. They're really innovative, and they're always trying to gain that, you know, competitive edge and get access into our information. So I think they are very well aware that small organizations might not have the capital to get the cybersecurity or the time, whatever it may be, and they definitely exploit that. So if there's one thing that you could do after this, I think it would be to go back and sort of identify those crown jewels and then maybe come up with some policies or some procedures or some cyber hygiene techniques to help augment that. So going on with the cyber hygiene, so some things that we can do as individuals to impact our cybersecurity posture. So adopt a security first posture, make it part of your culture. We all have a part in cybersecurity. Those phishing emails that come through, not filling out those Facebook surveys like Jill had mentioned. Those are all some minor things that we can do that can impact those. Collaborate with one another. I know we're all competing with other organizations, you know, in our specific industries, but when it comes to cybersecurity, I think that we all need to get together, work as a team, figure out what might be working so that way we can protect the United States, right? So I think if we go out of business, there's that scary statistic that everyone always uses, that 60% of businesses go out of business within 6 months of a data breach. It is super scary. It's super doom and gloom, but it's real, right? So whatever we can do to help each other stay in business, have competitive engagements, I think is really important to sort of getting an upper edge on hackers. Establish a cybersecurity incident response team and incident response plan. So incident response in general is a pretty expensive feat. We hope that no one ever has to experience it. The fact of the matter is that hackers are doing everything that they can to make you feel that pain and be in that position. So having a plan in place to know what you're going to do if something does happen is super critical. We've seen people lose their ability to prosecute individuals, insider threats, because of their action that they did. They lost the capability to track and get evidence so they could then prosecute that person. So keeping in mind those things, your actions, your reactions will have an impact on that. It's very important to look at that. Establish a cybersecurity risk framework, so walk through that exercise. Do a risk assessment. Again, identify your crown jewels, find some of your vulnerabilities. It's a great first place to start to build a plan that fits your organization, your needs, and your compliance requirements. And develop a mitigation strategy. So I'm going to talk about credentials a little bit more in depth. And this is, you know, obviously a focal point of the dark web. And you saw it, I think, several times in Pete's explainer video. Emails and passwords are for sale all over the place and very, very cheap. So your credentials are your email addresses and your passwords, which are fused together just as a fancy term in credentials. How are your credentials found? There's many different techniques, and I'm sure that there's more techniques that are being developed every single day. But phishing, spear phishing, whaling, farming are just a few to mention. So talk about phishing a little bit. This is an example of a phishing email that Pete put together for us. So there's some things that we should all look out for when we're looking at emails. You know, are we expecting the email? Are we expecting the email from the sender? Is there poor grammar? Hovering over links is one of the best things that you can do. So where it says return or replace your items in your orders, if you hover over that link, and based off of this information with the logo, it looks like it's coming from Amazon. So best practice would be to hover over that link, make sure that the domain is amazon.com. What you might see sometimes, and you have to pay very close attention to, is they might do am.zon.com to try to, you know, throw you off. Just change things a little bit just so it doesn't become super apparent to the eye. It isn't, phishing has developed so much in the last several years. It's not necessarily the Nigerian prince just asking for donations anymore. They are very sophisticated. Another technique that we're seeing too, where your orders is, how they've made that hyperlink, just say your orders. What some organizations or hackers are doing now is they're actually just listing out the URL. So they'll do www.amazon.com that you can see very clearly. But if you hover over the link, you'll see again that it has am.zon.com. So they're constantly trying to up their game. They're constantly trying to figure out how they can undermine, you know, the awareness that we all work really hard to stay up with. And then on top of this, so if we do end up clicking on one of these links, what they've become really, really solid at is they will set up and stage login pages that look exactly like the Amazon one. So you'll put in your email address and your password, and that goes right off to them. So now they have access to your accounts. And usually when you do that, they'll send you right back to the Amazon one and you can sign in again. So they're getting really good with their redirections. They're getting really good with replicating and staying to the brands of these companies so that it really does not stand out to you. I feel very lucky that we have email protection in place at Twin State. So what we have is sort of a sandbox that reads through our email addresses or our emails that are coming in, and it will put them into what we call a postmaster. Some people find that the postmaster is inhibitive to productivity, and I think that's a common trend with security in general. You know, we put security policies or technology in place, and sometimes that does impact our productivity, but I think that the ramifications of not having these in place are far greater than losing that little ounce of productivity. So I think that's a balance that we all have to look at. And again, when you build your plan, your cybersecurity plan, you'll take those into consideration. So this is an example of a piece of technology that you can deploy in your environment just to take away some of that risk from your user. If we have the sandbox that's pointing out to us, hey, there's something suspicious within this email. If you do put this email into your regular queue, just make sure you pay extra attention to it.
Alyssa,
COVID-19.
Alyssa, yeah. I have a question that I think goes with the topic you were just discussing.
Sure.
It's very timely. if you are at risk and you open the email, but you don't click the link, do you want to just talk a little bit like what to do with something you feel is suspicious?
Yeah, and I think that depends on how the email comes through, and you know, I might be out of my technical understanding here a little bit, but there's payloads and certain things that can be hidden within emails. I think in a general sense, when it comes to phishing emails, if you open the email but you don't click on the link, you should be okay. I think the link clicking is where they really get you, and then they get your information.
And I agree with that. Yes, that was a good answer. Yeah, if you do not click the link, then you have normally not activated whatever is what Alyssa refers to as the payload. And the payload is, you know, either the ransomware, it's the bot, it's whatever that you need. So that is where you don't click on it and basically just put it in delete. Again, that's where a good antivirus, anti-malware program, either before, again, like Alyssa had discussed, something that's an appliance that actually scans your emails at an enterprise level is something you can do, but also very important to have updated antivirus, anti-malware, because again, those variants out there are changing at all times. And when you have a product that is constantly also being updated, that's catching these new variants. I know some of you folks aren't really in the IT realm, so you don't get the bulletins and the other things out there that CyberPros kind of follow, so you don't know what the new variants are. But if you have a product that you can depend upon, then they're going to catch those for you also.
Yep, and I think that's a great segue. I won't get too much into it, but that's sort of, you know, the defense in depth strategy. All of these tools and technology that we have access to, they all sort of have their strong points, right? So sometimes it really isn't just having a firewall anymore. It's not just having an antivirus that you purchased years ago, right? The hackers are getting good at understanding, and they're very reactive and very progressive. They don't abide by any laws, right? So they're able, I think, to be a little bit more inventive sometimes. So having a defense in depth strategy or layered security, and then making sure that you keep that security updated, is definitely super important. I wanted to pull this up. I'm sure that many are aware of this, and they, you know, it was all over the news for a while. Hackers, they are ruthless. They really don't care what's going on in the world. As long as they make a good penny in the day, then they're happy. So this is an example of a phishing email that came through. The World Health Organization, as you can see, they have the right logo. It looks very legitimate. There is that minor spelling error there with cough, C, shortness of breath, and breathing difficulties, but it is relatively spot on. So the biggest risk here would obviously be clicking on that button that they have that has safety measures, and that would be where your defense in depth strategy would come into place, where if you did click on that button, there's something that, you know, takes care of that and tries to segment that from the rest of your network. I also, this is a little bit off topic, but again, just sort of emphasizing that hackers are willing to do whatever they can to make a dollar. They're actually getting into selling PPE. It's not typical of them. You know, it's not really a black market type deal, but there's a market for it. So I think that's another important point to bring about hackers and bad actors, is that they look at market opportunities. They really are savvy business people with a technical aptitude. So there's a lot of things that they are willing to do in order to make a dollar. One thing, we're on Zoom now, and it was in the news quite a bit, and I applaud Zoom for the quick response that they've had to rectify some of their issues. But so there's the 500,000 Zoom accounts that are being sold online. Hopefully anyone that had a Zoom account has updated their passwords. But just a little background on how this happened or what happened. So the attacker most likely went to the dark web. They purchased those email addresses and passwords, the credentials, for $25 or whatever it is. And then they used something that's called credential stuffing, and hopefully have my technological knowledge right here, but basically they use several bots, which are just computers, right, that have computing power, and then they go to a bunch of different sites and they just keep plugging in and plugging in and plugging in all of your credential information, just hoping that they hit that one that has the right username and password combination. So there might not be a lot of information on Zoom that someone might be able to get, but again, emphasizing that having diversified email addresses and passwords across different platforms. If you use the same username and password on Zoom as you do on your banking account, that's where the damage really is. So it's just keeping that in mind. And I've had this conversation with several people before, you know, I don't have enough money. You know, why would someone want to hack me? Well, if you don't have the policies in place to protect your information, that's what hackers are going to go after the most. They're going to go after that low hanging fruit. If they can make $5 off of, you know, a 10 minute investment versus maybe not getting into that Fortune 500 company, and having no return at all, they're going to go after the low-hanging fruit. So again, just awareness, if we're all more aware, it's talking about it, it's sharing information that's helping each other. There is a lot of cybersecurity awareness training available. People will do in-person. There's phishing, like I showed that email before. I'm not sure if that was sent to Peter or if Peter constructed that email himself. So we actually do testing at Twin State all the time. And you're always going to have someone that clicks on the link. I think that I've had a significant amount of training in the office and outside of the office. And I fell for one the other day. So it's just, which is again, where the having that defense in depth strategy. So I'm aware of the techniques that I need to do in order to protect myself from making that mistake. I hovered over the link. It looked legitimate to me, so I clicked on it, and then I got a friendly reminder saying that I got caught, and this is what I need to do next time I see an email like that. So that, I think that's a very valuable thing. It's life. It's, you know, real life learning. It's real life application. It comes into your email just as, you know, a normal email would come through, and then you get to have training behind it as well to support that. You can do on-site training, and then there's more online training too. So defensive approach, know what is underground. So know your systems, know your networks. Again, I think with the environment we're all in now, with the working from home, it's good to know what's underground and it, you know, experience or look at what things have changed. Again, I think Jill had mentioned making sure that your routers are up to date, your firmware is up to date. You don't have the traditional admin password information. Know your environment, understand your risks, start with a risk assessment, identify your crown jewels, and then do something. I know that it's not always easy to put a big plan together. Everyone's super busy. Cybersecurity is very important to protecting organizations. There are some very small things that you can do. Not every cybersecurity tool costs a lot of money, and sometimes, like awareness, that doesn't take a lot of money. It just requires being open and talking about it. And so we talked about the dark web and credentials quite a bit. We do have a service we call Unmaskify. It's our dark web monitoring service. And we are offering a free scan for folks today. If you want to email us at hello@twinstate.com, we will send you your free report. I think it's important to note, we've done quite a few of these. And not everyone comes up with any passwords on the dark web, but that's where the continuous monitoring comes into play, right? So you might not have it today, but tomorrow your information might be for sale on the dark web, and then you can act on it tomorrow. If you don't have the continuous monitoring in place, then you're going to miss out on that time. So, you know, we know hackers are quick, they're innovative. So the quicker that we can get that information, so what we would do here is we would recommend, if we see your username and password for sale on the dark web, that you change your username and your password immediately, or at least your password, so that they don't have access to those systems. And there's a, we've worked really well with NIST. Debbie's actually gone down to the National Institute of Standards and Technology several times and worked with them on the cybersecurity framework. We've built our cybersecurity stack around that. We think they're a really great organization, and they're really putting their best foot forward to help SMBs protect themselves in this growing threat environment. Protect your IP with your IT. If you have any questions, please reach out to us. And thank you so much, Jill and West Telecom, for including us today. Hopefully you all found some value in this, and the dark web is demystified a little bit.
Thank you so much, Alyssa. I do have another question coming in. And this one is about, how bad is it to allow your laptop and phone to save passwords?
Yeah, so I think having a system in place like LastPass, a password saver, is a little bit better. Remembering passwords, I don't recommend personally, even for my banking accounts, when I use devices, I log in, it'll say, do you want to remember this computer? Is this a computer you use often? I say, no, I don't want to remember it, so I can give myself that extra security layer. I think storing your laptop and your phone to save passwords, it really all depends on the platform you're using. And if you're letting them just log in and fill in that information automatically. And I think that it's sort of a layered concept here too. So if getting access to your computer is easy and your passwords are stored, that's where the risk really is. Hopefully that was helpful.
And again, it's about layered security, like we've been discussing in this webinar, in the sense that if you were to go out into, you save them through Google, and you can go out and you can actually unmask your passwords and take a look at them from over in Google. So again, it's about the layered security. If you're not letting someone into your computer because you have good passwords and you have good enterprise technology that's basically protecting that, then they can't get in from the front door. So it's really a matter of, what are you protecting? Why are you protecting it? And what are the best practices around it? And I think what's happened is that people sometimes get lazy, for lack of a better way to put it. I don't want to know all these passwords. I can't remember all these passwords. So that's why sometimes it's beneficial to an organization to have a partner like a Twin State that has the knowledge and can come in and if nothing else, just consult and give people an idea of what are the best practices to keep your particular environment safe, because every environment is different also. And it also, again, we touched upon it in the other webinars, we touched about it a little bit here, it's really your compliance level. And you know, NIST, which is actually the National Institute of Standards and Technology, they do a great job of laying out frameworks for folks. But when you get in there and you start looking at it, you're going to find that not everything is going to be pertinent to your environment. So that is where, you know, sometimes people look at cybersecurity and security in general, and it becomes overwhelming. You need to kind of break it down and what is really relevant to my situation. Do I need to worry about the SHIELD Act? Do I am just worrying about my own personal information, or am I worrying about my enterprise information? So I think if everybody takes a step back and takes a look at things like that, is where you kind of almost demystify the whole security around IT also.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, if you are storing your laptop your passwords, just try to implement two-factor authentication wherever you can too. So in case somebody does get access to that, you'll get the notification that somebody's trying to sign on. And if you're not actively trying to access that application, you can go ahead and deny them access from getting there.
And again, that's something we've discussed many times, folks, in every webinar. She calls it two-factor. We might have referred to it as multi-factor authentication or MFA, many different terms for that. Bottom line is that if you can have it on an application, you should be using two-factor, multi-factor authentication, something you have and something you know. Basically, that's what it is. And, you know, many folks are now moving to Office 365. And there are many, many security options that can be turned on in there, up to and including multi-factor authentication. So again, you can kind of go out there in your own portal and take a look around, or your enterprise should have security set for things like that also. And that's just one example. There's many, you know, from your Amazon account to your Google account. But those are the kind of things that maybe you should be questioning IT, you know, and saying, do you have this turned on or am I protected? Because that's really your first line of defense with your organization. Are there any other questions out there for myself or Alyssa?
Oh, I just want to thank you again, and Deirdre and West Telecom and everyone that joined us today. And again, if there's any questions, feel free to reach out to us and we'll try to help out as best we can.
Okay, I don't see any other questions coming in. Once again, I want to thank everyone for attending our third and final webinar in the Secure Your Home Office series that we've put together. I want to thank our partner TwinState here. Alyssa, you did a great job on showing folks what dark web looks like. Hopefully we did demystify it a little bit. And if nothing else, kind of take all of the webinars that we've done and from talking about securing that router, which is really something at the physical level, to if you don't do that, where you get to the point where that's where your passwords and your email addresses and all sorts of other information are out on the dark web. And that once it's out there, yes, we'll be putting this webinar out. It'll come through an email like the other ones have, and they will always be out on our YouTube channel. So that's just West Telecom on YouTube. And if that's it for questions, I want to thank everyone again for coming. And till next time, be secure, be safe.